Hello, I'm Dr. Karen Seibert. This is Dr. Ryan Gamlin. We're with the UCLA Department of Anesthesiology and Perioperative Medicine. And today we're here to talk about the management of the narrowed or stenotic airway with special attention to rigid bronchoscopy and jet ventilation. As always, we start with the basics in airway evaluation. Does this patient's airway look as though it will be difficult in terms of simply finding the vocal cords with a laryngoscope? Does it look as though it will be a challenge to intubate or reintubate? In that case, we'll want to be prepared with video laryngoscopy, a choice of blades, and other equipment as indicated by the situation. Is there reason to think that it might be difficult to ventilate the patient even once we've successfully intubated? Is there an area of tight subglottic stenosis? A large anterior mediastinal mass? A substernal thyroid mass? Tracheomalacia? An obstructing endotracheal or endobronchial lesion? All of these are problems to take very seriously. Remember that intubation alone does not solve every airway problem. A good way to formulate our decision making is this. Ask yourself if you're dealing with a fixed airway problem or a dynamic airway problem. Fixed obstructions may result from conditions like radiation fibrosis, tumor invading the airway, or subglottic stenosis. Airway stenosis can occur after a traumatic intubation, prolonged intubation, or after lung transplant. Subglottic stenosis can also be the result of a congenital web. And interestingly, this can get worse and become symptomatic for the first time during pregnancy. What we mean by dynamic airway compromise is a situation where the degree of airway collapse changes with each breath. Here we have to determine if the problem lies within the thorax or outside it, above the level of the clavicles. Tracheomalacia, or weakening of the trachea cartilage rings, can occur anywhere in the trachea, from the subglottic area all the way down to the distal trachea.
Airway obstruction inside the chest, or intrathoracic, is a problem where the trachea or mainstem bronchi are obstructed or externally compressed. In this situation, the airway will collapse on expiration and open more with inspiration. It can be caused by tumor, granulation tissue in the airway, or a large anterior mediastinal mass or substernal thyroid mass that compresses the airway. After lung transplant, you may see a combination of fixed and dynamic obstruction where stenosis from granulation tissue at the anastomosis is relatively fixed, but the tracheal or bronchial rings are prone to collapse as well. Conversely, when there is obstruction or narrowing above the level of the thorax or in an extrathoracic location, the airway will tend to collapse with inspiration, causing inspiratory stridor, and open with expiration. This can be caused by subglottic stenosis or tracheomalacia following thyroidectomy for a long-standing goiter, or by dysfunction at the level of the vocal cords themselves.
Anytime you're not sure exactly what you're dealing with, it may be a very good idea not to intubate or paralyze the patient right away. Instead, consider keeping the patient spontaneously breathing and insert a supraglottic airway device. This can be an LMA with the aperture bars removed, which you can easily do with a small sharp scissors, or use an eye gel, which doesn't have any bars and will easily accommodate a fiber optic bronchoscope and even an endotracheal tube. With your patient breathing, you can look down with the fiber optic bronchoscope, evaluate vocal cord movement, and evaluate the degree of fixed or dynamic airway obstruction that you've got to deal with. Whether the airway opens more when the patient takes a breath, and collapses when the patient exhales, or vice versa. This can be a very important part of the surgeon's or the pulmonologist's decision making about whether or not to insert an airway stent, use laser, use balloon dilation, or otherwise decide how to fix the airway problem. These photos all show the glottic opening and examples of subglottic stenosis. Here is why spontaneous ventilation can be so helpful. It tends to improve airflow through an area of stenosis because it's easier for the patient to pull air in than it is for you to push it in. It provides a margin of safety in case of unintended extubation or pneumothorax. Inhaled sevoflurane, as we all know, is an excellent bronchodilator. And if your patient's breathing SIVO, there's less chance of apnea than there is with propofol or remifentanil, and less chance of bradycardia than there is with dexmedetomidine. And don't forget how helpful a lidocaine infusion can be in terms of decreasing cough and airway irritability. Run it at 1 to 2 milligrams per minute. Remember that airflow speed increases as it passes through an area of stenosis. That doesn't matter if the stenosis is only moderate. But if the stenosis is critically narrow, then beyond that point, effective gas movement will be reduced by turbulence. The way to solve this is to slow the patient's rate of breathing by deepening anesthesia or by using a lower density gas such as heliox, which is a mixture of helium and oxygen. Once you've assessed the airway while the patient is spontaneously breathing, it's not a bad idea to pass an airway exchange catheter before you take out the supraglottic airway. This will help whether you're going to intubate or the surgeon is going to take over the airway by providing a direct visual pathway to the vocal cords. Here we're using a double lumen tube exchanger, which will fit right through the eye gel. It has a soft purple tip to reduce the risk of any trauma to the airway when you're inserting it, and there's plenty of length on it so that you can easily pass a rigid bronchoscope or an endotracheal tube or whatever airway device you're going to deal with. So now your surgeon has decided that the way to proceed is with rigid bronchoscopy, and as you can see, the rigid bronchoscope is in. What are the anesthesia considerations we need to worry about, and how are we going to manage this? It is possible to do rigid bronchoscopy with a regular anesthesia circuit hooked up to the rigid bronchoscope, and it has a port designed exactly for that purpose. However, it's very difficult to control ventilations under these conditions because you don't have a sealed airway. So you have to seal the end, and often you need to pack sponges in the mouth and be very careful to remove them at the end. If you're going to do this, it may be easier to keep the patient spontaneously breathing under deep inhalation or IV anesthesia and assist ventilation manually with the sponges, as we said, packed in the mouth. If muscle relaxation is required, you can use the oxygen flush as a way to deliver oxygen at high flow.
This is a manual jet ventilation setup, which may be all you have in some hospitals. It has a trigger, just like a bicycle or automobile tire pump, and you press that with your thumb to deliver a jet of air. They're difficult to control with any degree of precision, and as such can easily lead to barotrauma, breath stacking, or even a tension pneumothorax, which could obviously be a devastating complication in many of these patients with poor pulmonary reserve. A better solution is a jet ventilator, and here at UCLA we have a brand called the Monsoon. These are the basic settings for an adult patient. Rarely will you need anything different unless the patient is, for example, morbidly obese, when you may need higher driving pressures, or in the case of severe bronchospastic disease, requiring more time for exhalation and a prolonged I-to-E ratio. You set inspiratory time, driving pressure, frequency of breaths, and the pause pressure, which is very important, the peak inspiratory pressure, and what you want the FiO2 to be if you're going to be using the laser. If the surgeon is going to use laser, there's also a laser on-off button to instantly reduce the FiO2. You'll press it again when you want to resume higher oxygen flow. And while it may sound obvious, inhalational anesthesia isn't an option with jet ventilation, so you'll need to convert to TiVo with your choice of medications. Here's a view of the tubing and how it connects to the Monsoon and to a rigid bronchoscope. If you're working with head and neck surgeons, though, you may not be using a rigid bronch at all, and instead either they or a member of the anesthesiology team will insert one of these Teflon laser catheters through the vocal cords. They have a stylet to make them easy to insert under direct laryngoscopy and a lure lock hookup for the jet ventilation tubing itself. They're small enough to pass beyond an area of stenosis and deliver jet ventilation while the surgeon uses laser on the obstruction or mechanically dilates it. One thing, be absolutely sure that there's enough room between the catheter and the aperture of the vocal cords themselves to allow for the patient to passively exhale. Otherwise, there is a risk of breath stacking and resultant barotrauma.
This concludes our discussion of how to approach the management of the narrowed or stenotic airway and how to use jet ventilation. We hope you found it helpful. Some references are listed here to guide further reading. Thank you for watching.